You're listening to the audio production of And the Angels Were Silent by Max Lucado, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Ben Holland.
A word before. It's early in the final week. The props and players for Friday's drama are in position. 6-inch spikes are in the bin. A cross beam leans against a shed wall. Thorn limbs are wrapped around a trellis, awaiting the weaving of a soldier's fingers. The players are nearing the stage. Pilate is concerned at the number of Passover pilgrims. Annas and Caiaphas are restless over a volatile Nazarene. Judas views his master with furtive eyes. A centurion is available, awaiting the next crucifixions. Players and props. Only this is no play. It's a divine plan. A plan begun before Adam felt heaven's breath, and now all heaven waits and watches. All eyes are on one figure, the Nazarene. Commonly clad, uncommonly focused, leaving Jericho and walking toward Jerusalem. He doesn't chatter. He doesn't pause. He is on a journey, his final journey. Even the angels are silent. They know this is no ordinary walk. They know this is no ordinary week. For hinged on this week is the door of eternity. Let's walk with him. Let's see how Jesus spent his final days. Let's see what mattered to God. When a man knows the end is near, only the important surfaces. Impending death distills the vital. The trivial is bypassed. The unnecessary is overlooked. That which is vital remains. So if you would know Christ, ponder his final days. He knew the end was near. He knew the finality of Friday. He read the last chapter before it was written and heard the final chorus before it was sung. As a result, the critical was centrifuged from the casual. Distilled truths taught, deliberate deeds done. Each step calculated, every act premeditated. Knowing he had just 1 week with the disciples, what did Jesus tell them? Knowing it would be his last time in the temple, how did he act? Conscious that the last sand was slipping through the hourglass, what mattered? Enter the Holy Week and observe. Feel his passion, laughing as children sing, weeping as Jerusalem ignores, scorning as priests accuse, pleading as disciples sleep, feeling sad as Pilate turns. Sense his power. Blind eyes, seeing. Fruitless tree, withering. Money changers, scampering. Religious leaders, cowering. Tomb, opening. Hear his promise. Death has no power. Failure holds no prisoners. Fear has no control, for God has come. God has come into your world to take you home. Let's follow Jesus on his final journey, for by observing his, we may learn how to make ours. Chapter 1. Too little, too late, too good to be true. Those who have the last place now will have the first place in the future. Matthew 20:16. The only thing slower than Ben's walk was his drawl.
"Well, boy," he stretched his words and waited a month between phrases, "looks like it's you and me again."
Snowy white hair billowed from under his baseball hat, shoulders stooped, face leathered from 7 decades of West Texas winters. What I remember most are the eyebrows. Shaggy hedges on the crest of his forehead, caterpillars that shifted with his eyes. He looked at the ground a lot when he talked. He was already short. This only made him seem shorter. When he wanted to make a point, he would lift his eyes and flash a glance at you through his bushy brows. He fired this look at anyone who questioned his ability to work in the oil field, but most everybody did anyway.
I owe my acquaintance with Ben to my dad, who was convinced school holidays were made for boys to earn money. Like it or not, be it Christmas, summer, or Thanksgiving, he'd wake my brother and me before the sun was up and drop us off at one of the local roustabout companies to see if we could hire on for the day. Work in the oil field has about as many ups and downs as a drilling rig, so unless you were a company man or had your own crew, there was no guarantee of work. Roustabouts began showing up long before the boss did. Didn't make any difference who got there first, though. All that mattered was the strength of your back and the experience under your belt. That's where Ben and I came up short. I had the good back, but not the experience. Ben had the calloused hands, but not the strength. So unless there was an especially big job that justified quantity over quality, Ben and I usually were passed over. The elements of the morning became so predictable that now, 20 years later, I can still taste and feel them. I can feel the bitter wind as it stung my ears in the early morning blackness. I can feel the frozen handle on the heavy metal door that opened into the work shed. I can hear Ben's gruff voice coming from the stove he had already lit and sat beside.
"Shut the door, boy. It's going to get colder before it gets warmer."
I'd follow the golden light from the stove through the dark shed and turn my back to the fire and look at Ben. He'd be smoking, sitting on a 50-gallon drum. His work boots would be a foot off the ground, and the collar of his coat turned up around his neck.
"Sure do need the work today, boy. Sure do need to work."
Other workers would begin to trickle in. Each one's arrival lessened any chance Ben and I had of going out. Soon, the air would clout with smoke, and bad jokes, and complaints about having to work in weather too cold for jackrabbits. Ben never said much. After a while, the foreman would come in. Sounds funny, but I used to get a bit nervous as the boss walked into the shed to read the list. With the eloquence of a drill sergeant, he would bark out what he needed and who he wanted.
"Need 6 hands to clean a battery today."
Or,
"Putting in a new line in the south field, gonna need 8.
Then he would announce his list.
"Buck, Tom, Happy, and Jack, come with me."
There was a certain honor about being chosen, something special about being singled out, even if it was to dig ditches. But just as there was an honor with being chosen, there was a certain shame about being left behind. Again. The only rung lower on the oil-filled caste system than the roustabout was the unemployment line. If you couldn't weld, then you could roughneck. If you couldn't roughneck, then you'd service wells. If you couldn't service wells, then you'd roustabout. But if you couldn't roustabout... More times than not, Ben and I couldn't roustabout. Those of us who went unchosen would hang around the stove for a few minutes and make excuses about how we really didn't want to go out anyway. Soon everyone would meander out, leaving Ben and me alone in the work shed. We had no better place to go. Besides, you never knew when another job might surface. So, we waited. That's when Ben would talk. Weaving fact with fiction, he would spin stories of wildcatting with divining rods and mules. The dawn would become day, as the two of us sat on tire rims or paint buckets and walked the dusty roads of Ben's memory. We were quite a pair. In many ways, we were opposites. Me, barely 15 years into the world. Ben, into his 70th winter. Me, crisp and convinced that the best was yet to come. Ben, weathered and crusty, living off of yesterday's accolades. But we came to be friends. For in the oil field, we were common castouts, fellow failures, the too little, too lates. Do you know what I'm talking about? Are you one too? Sherry is. After 3 children and 12 years of marriage, her husband found a wife a bit younger, a newer model. Sherry got left behind. Mr. Robinson is. 3 decades with the same company had him one office from the top.
When the executive retired, he knew it was only a matter of time. The board, however, had different ideas. They wanted youth, the one thing Robinson didn't have. He got picked over. Manuel can tell you, at least he would if he could. It's tough being one of nine children in a fatherless home in the Rio Grande Valley. For Manuel, it's even harder. He's a deaf mute. Even if there were a school for the deaf he could attend, he has no money. A lost ball in tall grass. A day late and a dollar short. Small guy in a tall world. One brick short of a load. You pick the phrase. The result is still the same. Get told enough times that only the rotten fruit gets left in the bin, and you begin to believe it. You begin to believe you are too little, too late. If that describes you, then you are listening to the right book at the right time. You see, God has a peculiar passion for the forgotten. Have you noticed? See his hand on the festered skin of the leper? See the face of the prostitute cupped in his hands? Notice how he responds to the touch of the woman with the hemorrhage? See him with his arm around little Zacchaeus. Over and over again, God wants us to get the message. He has a peculiar passion for the forgotten. What society puts out, God puts in. What the world writes off, God picks up. That must be why Jesus told the story of the chosen workers. It's the first story of his final week. It's the last story he will tell before entering Jerusalem. Once inside the city walls, Jesus becomes a marked man. The hourglass will be turned, and the final countdown and chaos will begin. But it's not Jerusalem, and he's not addressing his enemies. It's the Jericho countryside, and he's with friends. And for them, he weaves this parable of grace. A certain landowner needs workers. At 6 a.m., he picks his crew. They agree on a wage, and he puts them to work. At 9 o'clock, he is back at the unemployment agency and picks a few more. At noon, he is back, and at 3 in the afternoon, he is back. And at 5 o'clock, you guessed it, he's back again. Now, the punchline of the story is the anger the 12-hour laborers felt when the other guys got the same wage. That's a great message, but we'll save it for another book. I want to hone in on an often forgotten scene in the story. The choosing. Can you see it? It happened at 9 o'clock. It happened at noon. It happened at 3 o'clock. But most passionately, it happened at 5 o'clock. 5 in the afternoon. Tell me, what is a worker still doing in the yard at 5 in the afternoon? The best have long since gone. The mediocre workers went at lunch. The last string went at 3. What kind of worker is left at 5 p.m.? All day, they get passed by. They are unskilled, untrained, uneducated. They are hanging with one hand from the bottom of the ladder. They are absolutely dependent upon a merciful boss giving them a chance they don't deserve. So, by the way, were we. Lest we get a bit cocky, we might take Paul's advice and look at what we were when God called us. Do you remember? Some of us were polished and sharp, but papier-mâché thin. Others of us didn't even try to hide our despair. We drank it. We smelled it. We shot it. We sold it. Life was a passion pursuit. We were on a treasure hunt for an empty chest in a dead-end canyon. Do you remember how you felt? Do you remember the perspiration on your forehead and the crack in your soul? Do you remember how you tried to hide the loneliness until it got bigger than you, and then you just tried to survive? Hold that picture for a moment. Now answer this. Why did he choose you? Why did he choose me? Honestly, why? What do we have that he needs? Intellect? Do we honestly think for 1 minute that we have or ever will have a thought he hasn't had? Willpower? I can respect that.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.